welcome to our online worship this Sunday in Lent. My name is Pastor Rhonda, and we are worshiping together as Holy Trinity Lutheran Church, Mercer Island, Washington. I hope you are enjoying spring as much as I am, as you can see with the beautiful flowers behind me. Let us keep in mind all of the blessings that God gives to us in creation and together as we are God's people, specifically journeying with Jesus towards the cross and ultimately the Easter promise of the empty tomb. Thank you for joining us today for worship. We hope that this time inspires you in your faith. And we also welcome Pastor Andy from our Northwest Washington Synod. Pastor Andy Yee is the assistant to our bishop, and he will be bringing our scripture and messages to us today. So, thank you for joining us for worship. Make your space holy and sacred, dedicated to God, wherever you are. And let us now begin. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for this time of worship today. We ask that you would bless us as your people, as we open our hearts and our minds to hear scripture, your word proclaimed to us. Help us, Lord, to learn and to grow together, to be your disciples, to share faith, and to walk with Jesus to the cross and empty tomb. In whose name we pray, amen.
Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord, join in a song with sweet accord, and thus around the throne, and thus around the throne. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Let those refuse to sing who never knew our God, but children of the heavenly King, but children of the heavenly King, may tell their joys abroad, may tell their joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The hill of Zion yields a thousand sacred sweets. Before we reach the heavenly fields, before we reach the heavenly fields, or walk the golden streets, or walk the golden streets, we're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Then let our songs abound and every tear be dry. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground, we're marching through Emmanuel's ground, to fairer worlds on high, to fairer worlds on high. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward.
Greetings, everybody. For those of you who I haven't met yet, I'm Pastor Andy Yee, working on behalf of the bishop in the bishop's office and assisting there. So great to be here with you. As always, thank you so much for your partnership in the ministry. And I'm happy to share the word with you today. A couple of lessons to share with you this morning. First, from Genesis 2. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground. But a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man who he had formed. And out of the ground, the Lord God made to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight, that is good for food, and the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to till it and to keep it. And the Lord commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree in the garden, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in that day that you eat of it, you shall die." And a lesson from John 9. Listen to the word of God. As he walked along, he saw a blind man from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's work might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." And when he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud onto the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go and wash in the pool of Siloam." And then he went and washed and came back and was able to see. And this is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. As I begin, I would like to acknowledge that I'm sharing today while I'm on the ancestral lands of the Coast Salish peoples, and in particular, the Stillaguamish, Skagit, Tulalip, Snohomish, Swinomish, and even the Duwamish tribes. I would like to acknowledge their ancestors who lived in this area and were removed here intentionally, forcefully, and sometimes even systematically. I'd like to begin our time to say that we see you. We respect your right to sovereignty and self-determination. And we're committed to being better listeners, learners, and in lifting Indigenous voices. Yes, I'd like to begin like this. Well, grace to you, my siblings in Christ, from our Lord and Savior, Jesus as the Christ. Amen. When the disciples of Jesus asked if this man's blindness was because of the sin of his parents or the man himself, Jesus answered that it is neither. It's more than saying to his disciples that their question was a little bit off. No, it's more than that. Jesus' response challenges the very core of how the disciples saw the blind man. The years of conditioning and even the years of tradition that have taught the disciples to see with eyes of power over others, and their need to drag God into justifying their need to see this way. It's not that the disciples' question is a little bit off, but that the question is totally wrong. And in actuality, we are invited to see something completely different. Many of you know that one of the things that I help out in the bishop's office is with congregational transitions. And one of the books that I'm reading about transition starts off in the introduction in this way. Listen to this. "Everything that you have ever learned about transition ministry is completely wrong." Well, that stopped me in my tracks, as should Jesus' response here, maybe should for many of us stop us in our tracks, especially in this Lenten season. The Lenten season has traditionally been a time of preparation for those who are preparing for baptism as we head into Easter. And this totally makes sense, as Easter involves some of the major scandals of life overcoming death, of the presence of God fully and alive among those who have been beaten, ridiculed, and tortured, and even left for dead. And out of the cross and out of the tomb proclaims what one of my favorite theologians, Rene Girard, terms the intelligence of the victim. We are talking about major reversals of what we know as logical and after years of conditioning of what we know as true about power. The Lenten season is a time to prepare to see something different. So siblings in Christ, this is not just an opportunity for those who are preparing to be baptized, but it will also be an opportunity for us, for all of us. It's an opportunity for us, the baptized, to be changed. And before we move too quickly to, well, then what is the truth that I need to believe in? Let us take a moment to take this truth, that it may be also so different than ours, so seriously that it stops us in our tracks. Maybe it is this stopping in our tracks at this time in our that might open our hearts, might open our ears, and might open our whole beings to let a whole different reality completely sink in. And that might prepare us for some of the huge reversals come Easter, right? Jesus here challenges who we think is blind in the first place. Jesus locates the real blindness in his disciples and all who fail to see that it is in this man who was born blind, where the fullness of God's creativity will take place. Our version of blindness is totally reversed. Taking center stage will be the ones who were pushed to the margins, forcefully, violently, systematically, and even religiously. Taking center stage for us will need to be the voices of the victims who are beaten and attacked and those who are silenced. We will never be able to come to a place where we can ask the right questions simply through an intellectual exercise. True change can only happen when those who were pushed to the margins are given the opportunity to now invite us to the table so that we can now get a chance to eat what is set before us. Land acknowledgments are good. And let it be also a time when we can recommit ourselves to being better listeners, learners, and lifting up indigenous voices, like I said earlier. Can we learn from those who were here before us, who have developed for thousands of years a unique spirituality with so much of creation? Recycling is certainly good. I'm driving a couple of electric cars. We put solar panels on our roof and we installed a super efficient heat pump. But I'm wondering if there is also something that is calling me to a deeper and a different place. Maybe creation needs to take center stage, and her voice needs to find herself into my ears. Maybe we need to respect creation so much that we not only strive to protect her, but also that she can then actually teach us. I've been fascinated by this area of science called biomimicry, a type of science where they are allowing creation itself to teach us, and maybe then we need to be better listeners. Tons of examples are out there, but let me give you just one: butterfly wings. Because of the ways that that they are structured to emit beautiful colors, is teaching us everything from how to make paints without toxic dyes, how to create brilliant colors on TVs without using toxic chemicals, and even how to put a coating on building windows in really hot places to help reflect sunlight so that we can reduce our reliance on air conditioning on the inside. Maybe the phrase that kicks off our Lenten season on Ash Wednesday, which you probably heard as, "You are dust, and to dust you shall return." Maybe that needs to change, right? Maybe it changes to something like, "You are earth, and to earth you shall return." reminding us that we were created with the same breath that created all of creation, that we were meant to be stewards of creation and be a part of its creative process, and that we are living in sin when our relationship with creation grows further and further apart and we fail to hear her voice. This is the blindness that we need to be saved from. I have a colleague that offers this as a part of what he calls a green Ash Wednesday. When it comes to racism and wanting to be diverse and inclusive, is there something larger that should come into play? What are the voices that need to come into the center stage? How do those voices change our theology? How do those voices change the way that we have been conditioned and traditioned for so many years? How can those voices be respected so much that maybe our commitment is that the ones who need to be changed is us? And because your unique voice is in our community, now the onus is on us to fundamentally change because of you. Politics can be so good and necessary, but when can our politics blind us from listening to those who've been pushed to the margins, dehumanized, and silenced for the greater good? The fighting needs to stop. We need to be challenged at our very core with everything that we were taught as true, culturally sometimes, politically sometimes, and sometimes even religiously, so that we can be taught and caught by the voices of those who are victimized. With what has been happening in the Ukraine, there is no shortage of victims. What has been happening in Palestine, there is no shortage of victims. What has been happening in our own country among people of color, still, even after years of what Martin Luther King Jr. started and helped us dream about, there is no shortage of victims. Even in my own household, where there is this power play that sometimes happens between brothers, there is no shortage of victims. It is time for the victims to then take center stage so that our blindness might be healed. The scandals of Easter are just around the corner. Life overcoming death, the presence of God fully alive among those who were beaten, ridiculed, tortured, and even left for dead. Out of the cross, out of the tomb, what one of my favorite theologians, Rene Girard, terms the intelligence of the victim. The time is now when we are invited to prepare for the power of those scandals. The time is now for God's creative work to take place, beginning with putting our victims on center stage. The time is now to recommit ourselves to learning and listening to those voices. Let God's creativity begin. Amen.
In the morning when I rise, give me cheer.
Together, let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for this time of worship, to be reminded that you are a God who turns things around. We remember that especially in this season of Lent. You turn our lives around from sin and death to the promise of hope and new life. Strengthen us, Lord, in this promise. In Jesus' name, amen. And now together we pray the prayer that Jesus himself has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Great is thy faithfulness, great.